Another set of music.
Deep Focus. I'm your host, Mitch Goldman. This one, recorded August 28th, 2014, Karl Berger and Ingrid Sertso, my guests, on the topic of Don Cherry. Why am I doing this introduction at the beginning of the first part? Well, and why was this one not uploaded a lot earlier in the series? This one was one of a bunch. We have a little fun, not so fun nickname for WKCR, the home of technical difficulties. Yeah. One of the three discs, the first of the three discs that I recorded the show on, did not come out. And so it's an incomplete program, but it's such a great show. I set it aside to air at a later date, and here we are. It's later. And the fact that I didn't put this one up initially was not because it wasn't fantastic, because it really is. This program means so much to me. It is, you're going to hear a story of love, devotion, innovation, commitment of a lifetime, and what Don Cherry called complete communion. I'm sorry we don't have the beginning of the program, but what you're going to hear is well worth missing out on that other part for, I assure you. If you happen to have recorded that show at home that night and you have it, let me know. You can email me at deepfocusnow@gmail.com, deepfocusnow@gmail.com. And okay, let's get right to it. This, once again, it was a Monday evening, August 28th, 2014, Karl Berger and Ingrid Sertso on the topic of the beloved Don Cherry.
You guys were talking about having met Don at Le Chat Qui Pêche, and that was around, that was 65 then, I take it.
Yes, April 65, we started there, right. And at that time, you know, that group was a group that could not really talk a lot together because Gatto only spoke Spanish.
Right.
And the bass player only French and English, and the drummer only Italian and French, you know. And I spoke German and English, and Don only English. Right. So there was no real conversation possible, you know.
But you guys played together for quite a while.
Yes, and also Don insisted on rehearsals every day. So we played every night except Mondays, but we also rehearsed every day. So there was a rehearsal at 4.
Right.
And Don would come in and say, okay, hello, that was it. Then he would pound things out on the piano.
Right.
And Ornette told me once, because I was wondering how Don did it, because he always came with new tunes.
Yeah.
And I was like, he was walking around with a shortwave radio headphones all day. And Ornette told me later that he calls Don the man with the elephant memory, because he could just hear a song once and then know it and play it. You know?
Yeah.
So actually, even Ornette, who was writing a new song every day, could not remember exactly every note because he wasn't writing in the beginning, you know?
Yeah.
Don was the one who remembered them, you know, the songs.
Don, it's funny. You know, I know some, maybe you can
give some insight into this. I am not a musician. And I know some composers who don't really spend a lot of time listening to music. They've got stuff in their head and they're, you know, responding to that and leading their band and whatever else might be going on with them. Don always was an avid consumer of music, just eating it, drinking it.
Yeah, exactly. So he would be hearing a line from some radio in Afghanistan or Africa or wherever, and he would just pound it out on the piano and for about a half hour, and then he would leave because he would like expect everybody to have the same kind of memory that he had, you know. And lucky for us, when the night came, he had heard some other songs, so he wasn't really playing those.
Yeah, that was insane. There was a rehearsal, an intense rehearsal, and in the evening he played none of that stuff.
Yeah, so it was like you had to be on your toes with Sherry all the time.
Oh,
you know?
I'm sure.
He was like, you know, but there were like some fundamental tunes, about 20, 30 of them, which were his composition and which we played like all the time and which I'm still playing today. Like next Tuesday, we're actually going to play a set at the Stone with that music, you know, Don Cherry's music that he then and with players who played with Don also. And so these songs are still with me. Like we're still playing these songs, and Ingrid too. You know, and actually Ingrid started writing some new texts to some of the songs, like Manhattan Cry, for example, or Remembrance, which, you know, and so this was like a process over the last, I don't know how many years now.
And you were writing, too, after a period of time, right?
Yes, yeah. But it was mostly a mix of his pieces, Ornette's pieces, and then whatever he had heard on the radio. You know,
he was remarkably consistent that way. All these things that you're saying are things that, as much as his music continued to evolve, and he was wide open discovering new things, he was an antenna, but very consistent in that way.
Well, he had a talent that I haven't seen anyone really show me that way, and that is he could like replicate a sound,
yes,
as complex as, let's say, Thelonious Monk chords.
Yes, that's exactly what I was thinking. I was hearing in my head him playing Bemsch's Swing.
Yeah.
And you've heard 1,000 pianists play it.
Yeah.
And he wasn't primarily a pianist.
He wasn't a piano player, but he could not only find the right notes, he'd find the right shades.
Yes.
He'd find the right dynamics. He would make it sound like Thelonious.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was uncanny, you know?
Yeah.
It was something I could not believe. He would like pound out songs by Thelonious on the piano. And I thought Thelonious is in the room, you know, and he's not a piano player.
Yeah.
So now even seasoned piano players have a real hard time even figuring out what the hell Thelonious does in order to, like, you know, Ingrid and I were, when we first came here, one of the first visits we did was at the Village Vanguard. And there was a double bill of Thelonious Monk Quartet and Bill Evans Trio.
Wow.
Alternating, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if we wouldn't have been there seeing it with our own eyes, I would have sworn there was a different piano on stage for the Thelonious set and for the Evans set.
Sure.
Like, when Thelonious came on, he started playing. I said, now this piano is gone. It's out of tune now. And Bill Kumane would be perfectly in tune. Like, you know, so that's like a huge lesson, you know, like to understand that you can really dynamically shade the sound so it sounds like a different tuning.
Yeah, yeah, you know? Yeah, yeah.
So I'm that's guessing, the kind of stuff that I learned from Don. You know?
I'm imagining Monk playing a lot harder than Bill Evans, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah.
and
yeah, but also like you know, you may find the right notes, but you're not going to get the sound, you know, unless you find the dynamics for each finger.
And it's funny, you know? In particular, to say that about, it would be one thing to say that about a trumpet, where, you know, everybody could play the trumpet, they're going to sound different. But a piano, you really are playing that note.
Yeah.
But the difference in touch is
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And so, the next step beyond that, I would say, and tell me if you would agree with this, not only could Don do all that, but he was also drop dead certain you could do it.
Yeah, of course.
And that was, it was just, for him, it was like breathing, it was like walking, it was...
Yes.
Of course you can do that. Go ahead.
Yeah, exactly.
We're going to do it together. It's going to be great.
Yeah, exactly. So this music has been with us all these years. So next week I'm doing this residency at the Stone for a whole week.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about that. Yeah.
And we're going to open Tuesday night with Don Cherry's music from that time.
Fantastic.
You know, so it'll be like all these songs that we recorded on Symphony for Improvisers and then later in other recordings, you know, and you're actually going to play some of those recordings from Europe.
Yeah.
And with us will be people that Don met through the Creative Music Studio, which we started later, which Don was a very huge influence to get going, you know.
I hope we can see how much we can squeeze into a brief 3-hour blink of time tonight.
Yeah, I just wanted to.
But I was just going to give people, if you don't know, you should know about Creative Music Studio that you went on to form with Don Cherry and Ornette Coleman in Woodstock, and that became a vital resource for this music. And we did do a show about that, talking about the way that you together developed the idea and answered the question, how should this music be taught and shared with the next generation?
Exactly.
Which is...
The school, you know, I thought the schools would like sort of take it over after we closed in the 80s, but they haven't been able to do it. Like, you cannot do that in a school system, you know, obviously, because there is just a whole other approach necessary, you know, to go really for the individual dynamics and timing and things that the schools are not able to really relate in that kind of depth, you know?
Yeah.
You know, like, because the material is so overwhelming that to learn, and then everybody gets stuck there. And people leave school and they think they got it, but all they got is the notes. They haven't really
They don't have the touch.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Know? And so, of course, individual teachers will always know that and teach that the right way, you know. But the Creative Music Studio, we were trying to really get our main focus on elements that are common to any music and that at the same time are very, very personal, you know.
Yeah.
That become totally personal, you know. And Cherry was a very big influence. So actually, with the help of a new executive producer that joined us, Rob Saffer, we are now doing those workshops again. Not really year-round, like we, because we don't have the facility and money and all of that, but now we're doing like fall and spring sessions. So we actually have another one coming up end of September. And so people like Marty Ehrlich and John Hollenbeck and actually Steve Gorn and Badal Roy will be there doing the Indian work. And then Ingrid, myself, are doing all this basic practice, which deals with the rhythm, the sound, the breath.
The voice.
And then the improvising orchestra that we're doing in New York the last 3 years. We do that every night, every day as well.
Fantastic.
And then people jam and play together. So that's like this is the second year that we're doing it again, and it's really great a great field. It's a beautiful resort out there called the Full Moon Resort.
And where is that exactly?
Huh?
Where exactly?
It's in Big Indian, New York, which is about 20 minutes north of Woodstock.
And let me just catch people up if they're just joining us. The show is called Deep Focus. Our guests tonight, Karl Berger and Ingrid Sertso. If you are an improvising musician or know someone who is, these people you're talking about are bright lights of this music. These are people who have the greatest experience and created music together and with others throughout the world. And this is a magnificent resource to put before a developing musician.
And also, by the way, we have like over several people in these workshops who are not even musicians, but they are just like very close and they're listening and just like want to be around it and develop their life. Because the musical principles are principles of life, you know, like you improvise all the time. And you think there's nothing to learn. There's plenty to learn, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, it's a big part of this show. We were talking about it off mic earlier that big thing we're trying to share is the idea of what it means to listen.
Well, if you don't mind, I'm going to mention where you find the information.
Yeah, I was just about to ask you that. Yeah. See, we're improvising together.
Yeah, if you go to the web pages of creativemusicfoundation.org, that's where you find videos from the last sessions, and you're going to find the background and the philosophy. You find some blogs of mine, and you also find archive information of the last 400 tapes that we are actually digitizing for actually here for Columbia University
Fantastic.
Library. And actually, there is a bunch of Don Che things that you don't know.
I bet. Thing about this, the more.
So, about 6 months from now, we should have another one where we can, like, get you.
Yeah.
acquainted with all that stuff.
The best thing about this is the more I find out I don't know, the more there is to discover. Creative Music Foundation. creativemusicfoundation.org.
Yes.
creativemusicfoundation.org.
Right. And so there's actually, we are doing archive releases now. We're starting it too, you know. So the first compilation is out. So these compilations will come out through the Innova Records.
Uh-huh.
And but then we want to start a digital label where with the in collaboration with the artists who we feel own all the intellectual rights of their music, we will together release some of that music over the next years.
Fantastic.
Yeah. But it'd be more like digitally rather than creating CDs and pressing, because that would be like a capital input we just can't make.
You know,
we'd rather put the money into life.
Sure.
And creating new music and connecting with people around the world, you know.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And let's talk just a little bit more, if you don't mind, about what's happening at the Stone.
Yes.
You said the first night is some of the same music that you were playing with Don Cherry.
Yeah, the first night will be really dedicated to Don Cherry's music with people who, actually, most of them met Don through us. At CMS, for example, Peter Apfelbaum and Steven Bernstein will be there.
Great.
Both of which were like 18 years old when they came to the Creative Music Studio to meet Cherry in a workshop.
I've interviewed both of them about that, as a matter of fact.
Right, and Peter later was music director for Don for quite a while.
I remember Don sitting in that chair where you are sitting saying, hey, I've had a great time living in New York all these years.
Well,
I'm moving to San Francisco to be part of this thing Peter's doing.
Yes. Yeah. So, and Peter did a wonderful job, like taking Dom into various directions, you know, creating opportunities with the hieroglyphics and all of those things, you know.
Peter's got some big ears.
And then there was another band where Mark Elias played with Dom. And that's Mark will be on the Tuesday night gig as well.
Yeah,
you know, and unfortunately, Blackwell, who's always been our drummer, is no longer around. So Tani Dabal will play drums, who's
fantastic.
So close to his playing. You know, he's sort of really in that school of feel. You know.
Yeah.
So if Hamid would live in New York, he would probably want to play on that as well.
I'm sure you would be there.
Right.
It's this is all happening at the Stone.
Tuesday night. Yeah, Tuesday, so, the 2nd of December.
The so Stone is, let me just tell everybody.
September.
The Stone is something you're hearing, Greg.
Yeah.
The Stone is Avenue C and 2nd Street.
Yeah.
And then
so it'll be an 8 o'clock and a 10 o'clock set with that. And actually on the 10 o'clock set, I invited a German guitarist, Carsten Radke, to play with us because he's part of our European group, which we just started in Berlin a few months ago. We were, Ingrid and I were at a festival over there, and we decided to start a European group with Baby Summer and others. And so Carsten is just in New York right now, so I invited him to come and play with us.
Yeah. And continuing through the week?
Yeah, then after that, Wednesday and Thursday, we're doing things that are just happening now that are not released yet. A new group where Ken Filiano and Kenny Wessel, the guitarist, plays with Ingrid and myself. So sort of as a fundamental quartet.
Mm-hmm.
And we are adding, on the first night, Carsten will be there again for one set. But then in the second set, Kirk Nofke will join us.
Mm-hmm.
And I just did a tour album with Kirk Nofke, actually a double album for the No Business label in Lithuania. And so we'll do some duets at the 10 o'clock set and then with the whole group. So 8 and 10 again with that, we call it Kick, you know, which is Carl, Ingrid, Kenny, and Ken.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Uh-huh.
And Kick will play Thursday as well. And Thursday, Jason Wang will join us, the violinist.
Yeah.
And I did some other duet recordings with him, so the 10 o'clock set will start with those duets.
Great.
Yeah. And then Friday will be a tzaddik night, you know, because I'm, as you might know, John Zorn invited me to record piano music for tzaddik, and the first solo album came out already a couple of years ago, 3 years ago, called Strangely Familiar.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually got quite a good reception. It's very special kind of music, very kind of emphasizing space and silence and moving like very, very, in very reflectively. And the 8 o'clock will be that solo set. I'm going to play those compositions from the CD. And the 10 o'clock set will be the next release, which we were hoping it would be a CD release party, but now it's only coming out next month, in October. So we're just like... And that has Harvey Sorgan on drums and Joe Fonda on bass. And it's similar tunes like Strangely Familiar. This one is called Gently Unfamiliar.
Ah, okay.
So that's the Friday night. It's like a Saturday night.
Yeah.
And on Saturday, we're doing something I called Close Encounters. We're going to play with William Parker, with Tyshawn Sorey, and Ingrid.
Wow. Nice.
And Ron Smith on drums.
Oh, fantastic.
And it'll be like a 8 and a 10 o'clock set with that. So that's like really new territory.
Yeah.
You know? And Tyshawn was actually at the Spring Creative Music Studio session. That's where I actually met him.
Oh, you know? Yeah. What a talent.
So that was this spring. He was one of the guiding artists at CMS at Big Indian at the Full Moon Resort, which, by the way, is a beautiful resort. You know, you can imagine. Imagine in the fall up there, all the colors and so on. You should come.
I think I might have to.
Yeah.
If you haven't been, you know, we put up with a lot living here in New York City. You know that.
Yes.
And
so now to finish this on Sunday.
Yeah.
Sunday night, we're going to do... actually, I forgot to mention with Tyshawn, also Graham Haynes will join us.
Oh, great. Yeah.
Right. And then on Sunday, I think it's Sunday that William Parker is joining us. I think it's, Graham Haynes is playing Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
Sunday, William Parker and Tyshawn will play with me. I should have my paper in front of me saying you find the information really both on our website, the creativemusicfoundation.org, but also, of course, on the Stone.
Which I think is it the Stone NYC?
Yeah, the Stone NYC, and there's a calendar, and it's very, very detailed.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the Saturday is really Graham Haynes, Ken Filiano, Warren Smith, Ingrid, and myself. And then the Sunday is Tyshawn Sorey, William Parker. That's the 8 o'clock set.
I'm guessing there are going to be a lot of people coming down multiple nights, night after night, this whole...
And finally, on 10 o'clock Sunday, we do the 74th performance of the orchestra, the Improvisers Orchestra.
Great.
Which John also started at the Stone 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And in the meantime, I thought he would go like for like a couple of times. It's grown to all these players. Everybody's playing with us. And the Stone is too small.
I was going to say, is there room for any audience?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So this will be like a special group, more dedicated to not like jazz oriented. It'll be more classical orientation in terms of the instrumentation. It'll be about 15 players probably.
The Stone. If you have not been to the Stone, this is an extraordinarily intimate venue, and this is a magnificent opportunity, a week long celebration of the music of one of my guests tonight, Karl Berger, and. If this music that we're playing speaks to you, you want to be, that's where you want to be. I was saying that we put up with a lot of stuff living here in this city, and you got to be nice to yourself. You got to come and experience things like this, these moments of magnificent, how can I even put it? This magical thing that happens, celebrating this music here in the city in places like the Stone, and to be in a place like Big Indian in the fall for this workshop.
I mean, it starts on September 30th. It goes till the 3rd of July, of October.
I've been very lucky. I've gotten to travel a lot around the world, and there have been many times when I've been in one of these magic places where you see postcards from, and I look around and I go, this is really nice, but it's not nicer than upstate New York.
Right.
It's beautiful up there.
Right.
That's as lovely a place as there is that I have found in the world. So do yourself a favor, listeners, and if you're hearing this and this is something you want to pursue in your life with this music, take the next step. There's no better opportunity, no better group of people to be around. So go to creativemusicfoundation.org.
Yeah, right.
Oh, this is very exciting.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Richard.
The show's called Deep Focus. This is WKCR FM New York. I'm Mitch Goldman, and our guests tonight, Ingrid Sertso and Karl Berger, and we are putting the deep focus on the music of the great Don Cherry, who really had such a shaping influence on your life. And I'm wondering, you know, when I mentioned this recording that we've been listening to this in itself, hearing these outtakes from Our Man in Jazz, this is unknown to the world other than a handful of collectors as far as I know. I should find out if Sonny Rollins has a copy of it. He should.
Yes.
And you knew right away exactly what I was talking about. Was that one of the recordings that when you were in Germany, when that first came out, was that on the radar for you guys?
Absolutely, yes. That was definitely right in that ballpark, you know. And we were like looking for every note like that coming out, you know.
Yeah.
Yes.
Was that maybe?
And Billy Higgins and Blackwell from the start were sort of my favorite drummers.
Yeah.
I never got to play with Billy, but we played with Blackwell all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And when Blackwell got really sick, we played with J.C. Moses,
mm-hmm.
and we played with few others, but it's just like there was no other drummer like Blackwell. When he died, like there was like we were looking for forever to really replace that feel, you know.
He had a flow.
I know. And he was also, you know, he would like never repeat himself. You could like not write arrangements for him. He would just play the arrangement of a song every time in a different way, and you would never know which one was more perfect. Yeah.
And what a sweet nature. I mean, he must have had another side, but if he did, I never saw it. He was just the most delightful.
Oh yeah,
man.
He could be really cutting too. Yes. I mean, he could not stand if somebody was not perfect. You know, like I remember one conversation in the studio where I said to Blackwell, let's do this tune one more time. And he said, why? And I said, well, I made a little mistake. And he said, that's your problem. I mean, we did repeat it, you know, but still, that's how he saw it, you know.
Wow.
Why did you practice at home? You know,
right. I'm sure. Now, Don Cherry, I could imagine, would say, well, there are no mistakes.
Right.
Right? It's all part of it.
Right.
Tell me, I was asking about when that record came out, Our Man in Jazz, this is the ensemble. It was from the same session we're listening to. Sonny Rollins, Don Cherry, Bob Cranshaw, Billy Higgins. What, for you just as a fan, as a listener, the impact of that? Maybe you could expand on that a little bit more and hearing this new direction for Sonny and...
You would not expect Sonny Rollins to play that way, you know. So Sonny must have like really enjoyed himself playing like that, because he played so inventively and also freely, you know, like just like going away from the changes and just like playing the music. It's just like we had heard it was Ornette. So I think that Sonny was, in a way, looking for that too, you know.
We're not gonna get to all this great music that I prepared. It's interesting we're talking about this because he plays some very different songs, and it's a very typical Sonny Rollins set list in a way. You know, he's got some. He plays Oleo. He plays Three Little Words. He plays some real kind of cornball stuff from the 20s, as only Sonny can, and you know, makes them new. And some just complete, what sound to me like improvisations.
Right.
And it's a little different shape than what comes through in the album that was finally released as Our Man in Jazz. So we'll get to some of that tonight. Listeners, tune in on future Mondays. We'll eventually get to play all of it. And but right now, I'm so interested in hearing what you have to say and about your experience with Don. Why don't we play one more track from this? And
okay.
Well, I've got some other cool things in the queue that I'm gonna drop on you that might open some new windows,
yes,
new ideas.
Right.
So let's hear one more track. This is another unknown title from the session that produced Our Man in Jazz, a groundbreaking session. Sonny Rollins now working with half of the group that became so well known, playing with Ornette Coleman in recent years. At this time, 1962. Don Cherry on pocket trumpet, Billy Higgins on drums, and Bob Cranshaw, who would be Sonny Rollins' bassist, already well established then and would play with him for decades to come.
Yes, yes.
And so it's a very interesting moment, and as you say, it's a real departure in Sonny Rollins' playing. So off we go to the Village Gate, which is no longer the Village Gate, but it is still a music venue, Le Poisson Rouge.
Le Poisson Rouge, yeah.
So some of our listeners might know that place.
Yes.
And, heading back down. How do you like this? Our CD player fell asleep. It literally says sleep. Is it still there? Hello. Good morning. And, off to the Village Gate. Come on, we're going to get in the WKCR time machine. Let's go.
Thank you.
on stage at the Village Gate, Sonny Rollins with Don Cherry, Bob Cranshaw, Billy Higgins. And that's from the WKCR archives, some of the music that did not make the album, Our Man in Jazz, 1962, July 30th, 1962. And playing that as part of the program, Deep Focus tonight with our guests, Ingrid Sertso and Karl Berger here in the studio. And really having such a great time talking with you guys about your experiences with Don Cherry, who's obviously one of your favorite people ever, aside from or in addition to what you said that's so manifestly true that you wouldn't be here without him, but also that you adored him, you loved him.
Well, you know, he was basically a translating Ornette's approach to music to us, you know. And so he was sort of a translator in a way, but he had his own flavor about it too, because he did the whole world music thing. He was the first guy that made it like completely plain that the common base of all the music can just be utilized in a very simple way by just like simply taking any melody from anywhere in the world or any rhythm that you'll ever hear and just use it your own way and not even worry about all these stylistic considerations and God knows what, you know. He would just go at the music completely naively and creatively, and that was sort of totally new, and nobody that did that before, you know. And that is basically, that became the basis for the creative music studio, you know, like that whole philosophy of there's a common ground to all the music and that you can study. And if you study that, then your personality will come out much stronger than if you study just in a certain style to start with. It's almost as if you would say, if you study a style of music, you start sort of in the first floor and you're leaving out the ground floor. You know, ground floor is what is music? What is the common base of what is rhythm and what is sound? What is common to every kind of music? And once you go there and you find like ways of actually really systematically work with those elements, then you have a ground floor in which you can join into any style. And once you join any other style, then like classical or jazz or whatever, your personality will shine through a lot more, you know?
You just put your finger on my definition of the word genius.
Yeah.
As someone who comes up with these ideas that, right. In hindsight, they're perfectly obvious.
Yes.
And it's kind of a wonder that nobody else put it quite that way before.
Yes.
And that's Don Cherry. That's perfect.
Right.
Perfectly.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, was his concept for that as completely developed as it was?
Mm-mm. You know, basically, my role was to actually conceptualize these things. He wouldn't even had said it this way.
It was just an instinctive thing.
Yeah, he was just doing it.
Yeah, right.
You know, he was living these principles.
And how did it dawn on you that this was happening, that there was a role for you to be played in his life?
I think so.
Did that, was that apparent? Was that ever discussed? Was that something that evolved over time? How did that work?
Well, you know, My background is also, I studied philosophy and musicology and had a way of learning how to organize my thoughts. And I sort of, the creative music studio started essentially with me asking, what are we doing? You know, why does it work?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So rather than, you know, Don wouldn't even bother asking any questions, right, like that, you know?
Yeah.
So it was sort of my role to sort of find out what is it. So I said, okay, if we tell the next generation, then we're going to, you know, it's sort of by formulating what we're doing, it crystallizes for me as well, you know. Mm-hmm. And it did, you know. So basically, the Creative Music Foundation studio is really nothing else but a crystallization of these principles that Ornette and Don, you know, Ornette always wanted to write a book, but he never did.
Yeah, yeah, it's always about to be released.
Because I always said that Ornette talks the way he plays.
Yeah.
You know, like he talks harmonic.
Yeah.
You know, which means a sentence starts and in the middle of the sentence it becomes another sentence, you know, and the subject becomes the object and so on, you know.
Now, is there such a book somewhere to be published or?
Yeah, I'm working on one, yeah.
Ah, okay. Yeah,
right, I'm working on one called Music Mind.
Ah.
And it goes actually another step further into the area of what your natural state of mind really is, you know, like somebody like Don was that spontaneous,
yeah.
You know, and we all can be that way.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
So, when you listen to the tribes sing and dance, you know, and we all thinking about stuff and having coffee while they all sing and dance, you don't see like half of the tribe sitting there listening. They're all playing.
Yes.
Everybody's playing. Everybody's dancing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So there's a community, you know, that we, the listener and the separation of the listener and the player is not as deep as it is made out to be in our society, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You can become a player in your own mind.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need to learn an instrument necessarily. You can go to that same place where we go when we play.
Yes.
You know, so as a listener, you can go there.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
So anyway, that's how it goes there as well. In other words, the book is not just about conceptualizing the idea of the common base of music and the personal sense of, and the beat for beat attention and all these things that we develop, but also about that, like trying to explain and bring in everybody into the music regardless where you are at right now in terms of being a musician or not, you know.
You are listening to WKCR. We call this show Deep Focus. I'm Mitch Goldman, and guests in the studio tonight, Ingrid Sertso and Karl Berger, taking over the Stone, starting a week from tomorrow, Tuesday night, and continuing through the week. And you can find out more about that at thestonenyc.org.com.
Yeah, I think that's what it is.
The Stone NYC.
Stone NYC, yeah.
And at creativemusicfoundation.org.
Right.
And I have a little surprise for you, Karl Berger, and that is a recording that features a very intriguing young pianist you might be familiar with by the name of Karl Berger. And this is a recording made in Stuttgart, May 12th. Do you know where you were May 12th, 1966?
Oh, my God.
I know where you were. Now I feel like Phil Shapp. I'm getting to tell you your life 50 years ago.
Yes.
You were in Stuttgart at the Beethoven Saal, Liederhalle, in Stuttgart, in with Don Cherry playing his, I suppose, recently released music from the recently released album Complete Communion. So this was the quintet we were talking about of Don's playing cornet, as it's listed here, Gatto Barbieri on tenor, you playing piano. The bassist is Bo Stief and the drummer Aldo Romano.
Huh.
And any recollections? Do you remember being there? Do you remember the venue?
Yes, in Stuttgart, right?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah, of course. But I thought it was Jenny Clark on bass.
Maybe, but maybe
because we
could
lived
be a mistake
in Paris,
here.
I remember, and I think I remember driving with Jenny Clark to that gig.
Uh-huh. Well, you come. I'm not challenging you.
Well, let's see. Yeah.
We'll see.
But also, I remember that we were. It could also be that I'm thinking of a different gig because I remember driving back with him to Paris in the middle of the night, and it must have been in the winter time. because we were like sliding on the ice. We had to stop and get into a hotel because we were almost had an accident. And so that may not be the same game. Yeah.
Or maybe this was maybe this is written. Oh no, you know what? It's possible. This is it says 1966-05-12. It could be December 5th. I might be wrong about that.
You say what?
It's noted. It says 1966-05-12.
Oh, so 05-12.
It might be December 5th.
I think that's more like it.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah, that's more like
it. I'm not Phil Shapp, I guess.
And if that is the case, then it would have been Jenny Clark playing bass.
Ah, okay. So mislabeled here as Bo Steve.
Well, because Bo Steve only joined the group in Copenhagen for 1 month because Jenny Clark was sick. And he couldn't come with us to Copenhagen. And the recordings that are out on ESP now, which were recorded at the Montmartre in Copenhagen, mm-hmm. That had Bo Steve. And Bo Steve basically jumped in. He's a local Danish.
Yeah, yeah.
And he jumped in at a very young age, replacing Jenny Clark. Ah. That was the only time I remember that we played with Bo Steve.
Aha. Okay, so that's great. So this is actually...
It could be... I can tell you from the playing.
Okay.
You know, like after this... But because Jenny Clark had a very very special way of playing the bass, so I would be able to tell you.
Okay. And anything else you remember about the gig or...
Only that we nearly had an accident.
It's going funny, back from things you remember. I'm like asking you, you know, this is like one of, I'm torturing you a little bit, asking you these questions. But let's see what comes back to mind when we listen to the music.
Yeah, sure, of course.
All right. So this is a really exceptional, rare recording. Made in Stuttgart. It's a beautiful, big, beautiful car. I've been to this concert hall.
Yeah, it's a place where they have their festival every year, too.
Yes. Yeah. Wow. And, it's a proper European concert hall.
Oh, yeah, it's
a
big concert hall.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. It's the Beethoven Saal in Stuttgart, and it's Don Cherry Complete Communion. So let us get in the time machine and turn the needle back to 1966. We are here with Karl Berger. The program is called Deep Focus on WKCR. Did I put it in the machine? Yes, I did. Okay, here we go. That is part one of two parts of this program, recorded Monday, August 28th, 2014. My guests, Karl Berger and Ingrid Sertso, on the topic of Don Cherry. Go listen to part two. And if you haven't subscribed already, please do so. Don't cost you nothing. You won't hear any ads. You won't get any reminders other than notification when a new episode gets posted, which I think is a pretty good thing. And you can also follow us along on Instagram. We are Deep Focus Podcast at Instagram. Deep_focus_. Did I say that right? Deep_focus_podcast on Instagram. And this show is all about going deeper and seeing how much you can pull out of the music that you listen to and everything that's around you. It's about consciousness. If you want to find out more about Deep Focus, you can go to my personal website, which is mitchgoldman.com, and pull down the Deep Focus tab, and you'll find more information about the origin of the show. Also, listings of every episode ever, most of which are already posted on as part of the podcast. And it's also searchable. Click around. There's a few different places to go. And part of it, there's a Google search tab that you can enter any information and find every time we ever talked about Don Cherry or every time that Karl Berger was a guest or whatever you might want to look for. So please go do that and come along for the ride. We're having a great time. Okay, I'll see you over at part two, second and final part of this program.